Good day. Today I want to share with you details of Barbados' economic performance for the first 3 months of 2018. The Barbados economy is estimated to have contracted by 0.7% during the first quarter of 2018. This performance reflects the combined impact of a decline in rail output in the tourism sector, the slowing of construction activity, the late start to the annual sugar harvest, and the slowdown of domestic demand arising from budgetary measures announced in the May 2017 budget. The supply of foreign exchange was more than adequate to meet market demand on a timely basis during the quarter, thus enabling foreign exchange dealers to sell some of their surpluses to the central bank. However, higher public sector debt service obligations than usual contained the growth of international reserves at the central bank to $14 million for the period. As a result, the import cover of 6.9 weeks at the end of March remained below the 12-week minimum holding that the bank considers as adequate. Government's fiscal consolidation efforts during fiscal year 2017-2018 led to a modest improvement in the primary balance and an overall reduction in the fiscal deficit from the previous year. But there was a significant deviation from the targeted outcome. This outturn is attributable to delays in the execution of planned divestment activities, the underperformance of revenue, particularly the National Social Responsibility Levy and the value-added tax, and higher interest expenditure than originally envisaged. Turning to the rail sector. Rail value-added in the tourism sector is estimated to have declined by approximately 1% compared to the 4.5% expansion in the corresponding period of 2017. Long-stay arrivals rose by 5.8%, with data up to February indicating that visitors from the key source markets of the United States, Canada, and the United Kingdom were up by 5.1%, 10.1%, and 6.5% respectively. However, the strong growth of shorter-staying North American arrivals, who now account for 42% of annual arrivals compared to 36% in 2014, was offset by a reduction in the overall average length of stay. Preliminary indicators are that cruise tourism activity was unchanged from the year before. Overall traded sector activity was also dampened by the delayed commencement of the sugar harvest, principally because of the late receipt of payments by the private cane owners for the prior year's crop. The harvest is expected to be slightly above the level of output in 2017, with production occurring during the second quarter of the year. In contrast to the first quarter growth of 2.3% in 2017, activity in the non-traded sectors is estimated to have been flat. Following its robust performance during the first quarter of 2017, output in the construction sector weakened, the result of the culmination of mainly tourism-related projects that supported activity last year, while new tourism-related projects continued to be delayed. Preliminary data suggests that the other non-traded sectors were adversely impacted by the fall-off in domestic demand caused in part by the tightening of fiscal policy. The average unemployment rate for the four quarters ending December 2017 was 10% compared to 9.7% for the previous year, but the average level of unemployed persons remained relatively stable. As expected, the fiscal measures were manifested in higher prices, but the potential impact was cushioned by the exemptions from the hike in the NSRL that were granted to a basket of consumer goods. In addition, with international energy prices trending upwards, particularly during the second half of 2017, domestic inflation reached 4.5% at the end of January 2018, relative to 2% a year earlier. The bank's net purchase of foreign exchange from the commercial banks was at its highest in 3 years. Foreign exchange availability benefited from the gains in net export of services as tourism earnings increased by an estimated 2.1%. At the same time, higher oil prices, increased consumer imports, and slightly weaker commodity exports offset some of the gains derived from tourism. However, the improvement in reserves was smaller than that for the same period last year, as the gains were eroded by higher debt service. Over the first 3 months of 2018, the international reserves held by the central bank increased by $14 million to end the quarter at $423 million. The financial sector remains stable, as reflected in above normal levels of capital adequacy and liquidity. These trends were driven in part by the ongoing weak growth in credit to the private sector, despite a relatively benign interest rate environment. The weighted average deposit and loan rates remained virtually unchanged, but the average mortgage rate continues to fall, reaching 5.6% from 5.9% 1 year prior. For the first quarter of 2018, excess cash liquidity in the banking system stood at 14.7%, down from 17.5% for the similar period in 2017, following the central bank's decision to raise the requirement on commercial banks' holdings of government securities. This policy decision had the simultaneous effect of substantially reducing the excess securities ratio. Turning to the public sector, the fiscal deficit fell by almost 1.5 percentage points to 4.2% in fiscal year 2017-2018. However, this was significantly above the small surplus targeted in the May 2017 budget as government attempted to reduce its borrowing requirement and place the debt on a downward trajectory. The consolidation effort resulted in an improved primary surplus balance of 3.9% compared to 2.4% in fiscal year 2016-2017. Total revenues expanded by 6.5% on the basis of increased tax receipts on goods and services. Over half the increased indirect tax state came from the National Social Responsibility Levy, the cornerstone of the new measures introduced in May 2017. However, exemptions from the tax for certain categories of goods and the fall in non-oil imports during the latter half of 2017 dampened the overall collection. The yields from excise taxes and VAT were up by 36% and 4% respectively, but the increase in the VAT did not meet expectations. In contrast, import duties actually declined. Taxes on incomes rose marginally as a one-time boost in corporate tax receipts was largely offset by declines in withholding taxes. The new foreign exchange fee and the transfer of profits by the central bank contributed almost 1% of GDP to non-tax revenues, which remained stable. Non-interest current expenditure rose by 4% as increased grants to public institutions and to individuals, a partial result of higher retirement benefits, negated a sharp decline in capital expenditure, arising from a slowdown in the number of public projects undertaken in fiscal year 2017-18. However, interest expenses increased moderately, accounting for 8% of GDP and absorbing 26% of revenue. Foreign finance project inflows were insufficient to offset foreign loan payments of $293 million. As a result, the fiscal deficit was mainly financed by commercial banks, which provided funding equal to more than 3% of GDP due to the change in monetary policy via the securities reserve requirement. Central bank financing fell to 1% of GDP when compared to the previous fiscal year, when it reached 9%. The private non-bank entities also reduced their exposure to government. As at March 2018, the gross central government debt, including borrowings from the central bank and the national insurance scheme, rose to 151% of GDP. Part of the increase, 2.3 percentage points, was attributable to the issuance of securities to cover the resolution costs associated with protecting the policyholders of CLECO International Life Insurance Limited. The government has also created a contingent liability by guaranteeing the payment of principal and interest of the bonds issued by New Life Investment Company, approximately 1.7 percentage points. A further increase in debt, equivalent to just over 1 percentage point of GDP, designed to protect British American Insurance Company policyholders, occurred early in the second quarter. And now the outlook. The outlook for the Barbadian economy remains challenging. Decisive stabilization measures that place the public finances on a sustainable path, alter the trajectory for international reserves, and create the conditions for strong, durable growth are now needed. Addressing the public finances remains a priority, so as to stabilize and ultimately grow the economy. Our efforts to date have not resulted in bringing the fiscal deficit to a manageable level. The demand for local government securities has declined, and the excess of external debt service over external borrowing continue to create added financing pressure. The impact of these developments in recent years has been a buildup of domestic arrears and increased reliance on central bank financing. The current borrowing requirement for fiscal year 2018-2019 therefore needs to be reduced. The task at hand is to implement a strategy that reduces the current year deficit, builds the platform for strengthening the public finances over the medium term, and fosters an environment that creates access to external funding. In addition, we need to create the fiscal space to enable infrastructural development that promotes long-term growth. In these circumstances, improving the outlook requires government's fiscal strategies to embrace durable expenditure reforms, including for state-owned enterprises, and improve tax administration. Given the estimated downturn in tourism in the first quarter and ongoing delays in project startups, the bank has revised downward its current growth forecast for 2018 within the range of -0.25% to 0.25%. This outturn is likely to be further influenced by the speed and nature of fiscal adjustment policies and the quantum of new investment. However, the outlook for growth requires an overall policy framework that includes measures to strengthen the business environment, promote competitiveness, spur innovation, and encourage emerging sectors such as alternative energy. Sustainable growth must be underpinned by an adequate foreign exchange reserve buffer. The modest reserve growth in the first quarter and into April needs to be supported by further inflows in light of debt service commitments and the risks of rising international oil prices. In this regard, the ongoing uncertainty related to asset sales remain a source of concern. Accessing increased public and private sector capital flows is therefore warranted to strengthen the reserve's position. Achieving these objectives is a major undertaking that requires commitment and focus by all stakeholders. I thank you.